Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today, inshallah, we are going to talk about the meeting 7, Introduction to Classes and Objects. The main thing here is introduction to classes, and from the classes, how we create the objects. This is the main thing in this meeting. And this is important in Java, because Java, the whole Java is based on the classes and objects. So even the Java package has the set of classes which are grouped as packages. So from here, we are going to talk about the Java programs as classes and objects. And this will be the last meeting for you in this course, M105. And you will continue Java in the next course, M257, putting Java in work or working with Java. There you continue from classes. You will be having as a revision for what we take in this whole course as one class, and then after that you continue with the classes and objects. Okay. So today's class is we are going to talk about classes and objects. So declaring a class and instantiating an object of a class, in which we see by example creating a new class employee and use it to create an object. It means that you are creating an object of an employee class. Like you create an object for a scanner class in your programs to read the value from the keyboard or from the external source. So here we'll see creating an employee class by giving some properties to the employee, for example, employee name, employee ID, employee name, employee salary, like this. And use the same class to create the object of the same class. Then each class declaration begins with a keyword called public and must be stored in a file name that has same name as the class name with extension .java. Whereas public is an access modifier which indicates that this class is public and available to all users, I mean all programmers. Now here is an example, public class employee, which has one field or one attribute, private string name, and one method, public void display info, which is just printing employee name. Okay. This is a class. So if you execute this class, will this be executed? No, it will not execute. Why? Because there is no main method in this one. For the execution of Java classes, we need to start with the main method. So until unless there is no main method in the class, the class will not be executed. It can be compiled, get the bytecode.class file, but it cannot be executed. So we'll just compile it, and we write another class called test public employee test, in which we write the main method and create the object of the employee class. How do you create this object? Like you create an object for the scanner class. You said scanner input is equal to new scanner of system.in. The same fashion, you are going to use the new keyword employee. This is the name of this class. My employee, this is the name of the object, is equal to new employee as a constructor. This will create an object by name my employee. Now when create this object, by using this object you can call the methods, the public methods here, or the public property here by using this object. Like by using the scanner object, you will call the methods like input.nextInt. The next int is a public method in the scanner class. So you are calling that by using the object name. The same thing here, what is the public method here? Display info. So you are trying to call this display info, employee.displayInfo. What it will happen? Employee is an object of employee class. So display info is a name method. I mean the name of the method in the employee class. This will call it, and whatever there inside, it will execute it. to do it practically, I'll create a new package over here, new project. Name it as meeting 7. The name of the main class, I will name it as an employee test. This is the main class. Now in this, I will add a new class called employee. This is an employee class. Now whatever the attributes or the fields you want with an employee, you can add here. For example, you want name of the employee, employee ID, employee salary, you add it here. Yeah. So we add the data usually by private. Private will come to the, in the coming slides you will see why we declare it private. Okay. So private, I will take one as a string name. Okay. And you want to take any other, you can take as many fields you want, you can take related with the employee. Then I'll put a method here. Methods we always try to put public. Okay. So now public void display info, and inside this I'll just print the name of the employee, system.out.println name of employee plus name. This name is this one. Yes, it is. The private is to be accessible only inside the class, not outside the class. Okay. So you'll see that in the coming slides. So okay, this is the employee class with one field, one method. Now to create the employee class object, you have to use the name of the class employee. My employee, then I named it as an employee one, emp1, new employee. And using this emp1, you can call the display info method. So now this you can just compile it. You cannot run this class because there is no main method. To execute this, we create another class test in which we create the object of this class and we call the method. Fine. Now we can run this method class and see what is your output. What is the output? Null. Why it is null? Because we did not assign any name to it. We did not set any name to it. So the default value for the string will be null. So it is giving null. So what we understand from this is that whatever the attributes or the fields of the class we declare, they will take initially a default value, but we can also set the value for it. We can also set the value for it. Let me take another attribute here as private int ID. You want age? I will take age, and I will take private int salary or double salary. Fine. Display info should display the info, the name, the age and the salary of the employee. So we write these statements for three: the name, the age and the salary. Now you have this, and again you call the same display info here. What you have null 0, 0.0. Null for the string default value, 0 for employee, 0.0 for double. Okay, so the next thing is how we can store the values inside. There are two methods here. Either you write some methods to store this values or to update its values. Or if you want to store some initial value at the time of creating the object, you can do that by using something called constructor. Not by arrays. By using getter and setter methods. We need to write methods to set their values, to set its values. For example, for employee 1, we want to set the employee, some values. Now, let's say I'll write a method to set the name, public void set name of string a name. Now, what this method will do, will set the name of the employee. Name, you pass it as an argument to the parameter. So we'll set name is equal to the parameter a name. A name is this one and the name is the variable. Like this, we can write a set for age, public void set age of int a age, and age is equal to age. Like this, we can write setter method for salary, set salary of double a salary, then salary equals a salary. You see how setting this one, we are calling this methods to set it. Okay, now how we can set the for any employee? We create an employee one, emp1 object. How we can set the name for this employee? How we can, because you see, when we create the object, an emp1 object is created. We have this emp1 object. This object has reference to what? The string name you can use this also here. Then we have the another property, what?
Age.
And the third property we have salary. Okay, initially we did not call any set on this one, because when we run this one, what we have? Null. To set this one, we can call these setter methods to set its values. Set name, set age, set salary. How we call? We use the same thing. emp1 dot set name of, give the name, the parameter, I mean the argument value. For example, Ahmed. This will set the name of the emp1. emp1 dot set age of, you give the age, the integer value, for example 20. emp1 dot set salary, you give the salary here, for example 500.5. now this name salary will be set here. Now after setting, if you want to check that value, you call display info to display it after calling the setter methods. Yeah. So now this is an abstract for it, and this is we are using it. Now if you run this one, we should get the name, age, and the salary. This is by calling the setter methods. Okay, this type of methods we call it as in setter methods, also called mutator methods. Mutator, yes, M U T A T O R. Mutator methods. Mutator is muting or changing the values. Okay. Now this mutator we call it as in setter methods. Setter or mutator methods. Where we write the set. The mutator method always have the return type void because it is does not return any value, and it will take the argument which the value to be set. In this mutator method, see, it is always void. Yeah, and it takes the argument, the value which is to be set. A name set, so a name is a string, the variable, then name is equal to the a name. Set age, age variable, age is equal to a age. This is all setting the values. Now, if you want to get only the name, only the salary, only the only one value you want to get. Now, in this display info, we are displaying complete. What is the name, this, this and all. What if we want to get only the name, only the salary or only the age? We have to write another type of method called accessor methods. These are also called, these are mutator methods which are called setter methods, and accessor methods are called getter methods, which will get the value, which will get the value. So how it will work, we need to write the get methods. It will be public again, public. Now what get, not void, because it should return the name. So it is a string for the name, get name. It does not take any argument, and it will just return name. Because this method should return the name. This method should return the name. So it will specify the name of the return type. I mean the type, the data type of the return, and the name of the method.
This method will return just string.
Just a string.
Yeah.
The next we have public, for example, you want to return the age. So you say get age. Like you write set age, this is get age, and this will return the age. And in the same fashion, it is public double get salary, return salary. So now here coming back to the main class in which you display the whole info, and now you want to display a particular info. You don't want to display the whole info. You just want to display the salary for employee one. So you need to write system.out.println salary of EMP1 is plus EMP1 dot get salary. I'll tell that. Now you see, we are trying to get only the salary, okay, getting a single value, how you will get the single value, okay. Now what happens in the exam, they'll give you one question, they'll describe what is the question. For example, write a class student with the following properties: int, the student ID, integer, student name, string, okay. And the methods, write the getter and the setter method, or they'll say write the mutator and accessor method. Access is get, mute it means set. So you have to write the same fashion what we did for employee. Write the getter and the setter methods. Okay. Now this is an employee class where in which you have three fields of the employee or three attributes. name, age, salary, and you have the methods, getter method and the setter method, to set the name, to set the salary, set the age, and you have get the name, get age, get salary, and you have a display info to overall whole information you want to display, that is display info method. Now with this class, this is one class employee. For this one class employee, we can create any number of objects, and every object has its own properties, own attributes, own values. How? Now in this class, I create EMP1. Like this, I can create EMP2. Employee EMP2 is equal to new employee. Now what happened here? Another name. So first object you have EMP1. One object. It has three properties. The name, age, salary. Then EMP2, another object. It has its own copy. Not the same. It has own copy of name, age, salary. The name here is different from name here. Yeah, you set the name again with EMP2. EMP2.setName, EMP2.setSalary, EMP2.setAge. You set the name for it. Like this, you can create, you can call the methods for the EMP. EMP2.getName will get the name of the EMP2. EMP2.getAge will get the age of the EMP2.getSalary will get the age salary of the EMP2. Like this, you can create 100 objects. So you see one class, you create how many objects? You can create any number of objects. Okay? And these objects you can run in any class, wherever you want. Okay, that is starts from the main method. The running starts from the main method. So you see why we separate this class now, employee class, because it's kept as a concrete or as a separate class, which is like a design of the class. So you see, we are not assigning any data in this class. We are just creating a template, a form like, from which we create the objects. That's why we keep it separate. And we use the objects of this class to do all these operations. In this class, we don't assign any value, we don't give anything. There is no value assignment, nothing. Only the template, the template code. And the rest of the things we do by creating the objects of this class. You want to add employees, new employee, employee 1, employee 2, 10 employees, 20 employees.
How we can information about
you create an object. For example, I got another employee. That is different thing. You want to create 10 employees by array or by using just in this fashion. That is different thing. Yeah, you can create an array. No. See, we don't take everything together. And you want to create 10 employees, you create it by one, or you create by array. You create an array of employee, and you create 10 employees as an array. You want to call for every employee, you want to call the get name. Or you want to display the name of all the employees, you put it in a loop. Okay, with the array of employees, you put the loop. So that is different thing. So later, if you want to make it for the huge employees and all, that you use the loops, use the array, same thing, you can use with these objects. Okay, like you create an array of integer, you can create an array of employee. You create an array of doubles, you can create an array of doubles. Use the same format, use the same for loop. Everything will be same. Fine. So the idea here is that to create a template From that template, you create the objects. So my concern here for you to understand that how we create the properties of a class, that is the fields of the class, and how we create the getter and the setter methods of the class, because this is important for you for the exam point of view also. Okay. Now this is one thing, that how we can create the objects and how we can set its values and get the values. Now while creating the objects, we have another way to set the initial values to the object when we create the object. That is by using something called constructor. For example, when I create the object, I want to set some initial value, the name, initial name, the initial age, initial salary. That can be set by using the constructor. By using something called a constructor. Now what is a constructor? Constructor is a method having same name as the class name and does not have any return type. For example, public employee. This is a constructor. This one is a constructor. Why we use the constructor? To construct or to set the initial value of the object at the time of creating the object. Like here, for example, let's say that the initial value for the name, we want to set name is equal to null and age is equal to 0 and salary is equal to 0.0, or we want to set the initial salary 500.0, the initial salary. Now whenever we create the object, this value will be given. For example, let us just check out this. And we create two objects, emp1, employee. See, this is a constructor. This will call this constructor and set the initial values. Now if you display emp1 display info, should display you the initial values: null for the name, 0 for age, 500 for salary, because the initial one what we set inside the constructor is this one. Or we can have an argument constructor or parameterized constructor to set the initial value, like public employee of a string, a name, the name what you want to set, int a age, the age what you want to set, and double a salary, what the salary what you want to set. Name, you assign a name. Age, you assign a age. And salary, you assign a salary. So now I'll use this parameterized constructor here for constructing the second employee. The second employee, I construct the name Ahmed, comma, age 22, comma, salary 1000.5. Sorry, 1000.5. Now emp1, I call the what constructor? A default constructor. This is called a default constructor without any argument, this one. So for emp1, it will call this one and set these values. For emp2, when I am creating the object emp2, I am calling what constructor? Parameterized constructor with the values. This will call this constructor with the name Ahmed, age 22, salary 1000.5. So when we display the info of emp2 dot display info, we should get the emp2 details. So constructors are used to construct the initial values at the time of creating the object.
It's not private.
It's not private. It is always public and has the same name as the class name.
Same name.
Same name as, and does not have any return type. There is no return, not even void. It will not, because it will not return any value. It is just to set the values. So there is no return type here, like here void. Here there is no return type. And there is no return statement. These constructors are used to set the values or construct the values. Okay? So you got the concept of constructor. So here, the overall idea here to show you that how to write a class, its properties, constructor, and the getter and the setter methods. In the exam, you will be having one question, the last question for you, to write a class by using some properties. Properties are the fields or the name of the variables.
Properties,
yeah, properties always we keep private. Why? Because we want to hide the data from outside access. Whatever we mention private cannot be accessed outside the class. It can be accessed only by the inside the class, the methods of the class which are inside the class. So for example, if I say here emp1.name, see, this is wrong. Why? Because name is a private. Even if I want to print it, system.out.println of emp1.name, it is wrong. Why? Because name has a private access. You cannot access outside the employee class. With this way, what we did, we hide the data from outside access. Like you can access display info. Why? Because it is public. You know, you can access it outside the class with the help of the object. But you cannot access the name. You cannot access salary. You cannot access age. Why? They are private and they are data. So always the variables, we try to keep it private to hide the data. This concept we call it as an in Java encapsulation. You are creating a capsule of a class in which you keep the data. The data cannot be accessible. And it is accessible, yeah, as in M107. And it is accessible only by the methods, the public methods inside the class. So here in this method you can access a name, in age. Why? Because it is in the same class. Outside the class you cannot access. That's why we keep the attributes or the fields every time private. So in the exam they'll give you the question and they'll mention the attributes. For example, name as a string, ID as integer, salary as double. Yes. Yeah, these are in privates. Then they'll ask you to write the constructor. A default constructor to set the default values? No argument. So this is a default constructor. Parameterized constructor to construct the values? This is a parameterized constructor. Now, the parameterized constructor can take only one parameter, for example, and the other values set the default value. Okay, or it can take two. So it not necessarily all parameters should come. I mean, all attributes should come as a parameter. Fine. Then we can have a display info to display all the information. Also we can have the getter and the setter methods. For every attribute you write a set method. For every attribute you write a get method. Or they'll ask in the exam, they'll specify, write the getter and the setter method only for name or only for ID or only for salary. So that case you have to write only for that. And if they ask for all attributes, write the getter and the setter method, you have to follow this, like this. Now remember that the set method does not return any value, they are void. They are used to set the values and it then take one parameter. And getter method always returns some values and hence they have the return type. And they return the values. they return the values. How to use this method? Create an object. In the end of the question, they'll say that create an object of that class, okay, and call these methods. Print the name, print the age. You have to call, do it by using calling the methods. Create the object by using the name of the class, by using new operator, and then call these all the public methods here. You can call it here with the help of the object. So here, for example, I want to call just the name. So I'll say emp1.getName. Okay, this will just give me the name of the employee 1 at the last. It is null. Employee 1, we did not set the name. We want to set the name before that, emp1.setName of Abdullah. Now it will display you what? Abdullah. Okay, sorry. So this will be one question for you in the exam. Okay, and this is what it talks about, the about the class and objects, classes and the objects. So in the classes and objects, what you have is that creating a class, defining their attributes, writing getter and setter methods, and writing the constructor, default constructor, parameters constructor. And then outside this class, in the main method, in another class, main class, where there is a main method, inside the main method, creating the object of this class and calling the methods. Okay, fine. Okay, this is almost half of the class is done and very little part left. So we'll pray Maghrib, and after that I will cover the rest of the part. So we'll take a break for 10 minutes. So that was the classes, fine, and creating the classes and creating the objects from the classes. Now instance variables, what are the instance variable? The methods, or sorry, the attributes what we have inside the class, they are called instance variables. Why they are called instance variables? Because every time you create an object, a copy of the variables is given for every instance, every object. Okay, for example, they said emp1 is created, it has its own copy of these attributes. emp2 is created, it has its own copy of these attributes. Every instance or every object you create, that object has a copy of that attributes or that variables. That's why they are called as an instance variables. They are called as an instance variables. Okay. Local variables are they're always declared inside a particular method or inside a body, okay, and they are not automatically initialized. You need to initialize them. Like the instance variables you saw, they are automatically initialized to their default values. We saw the string name was initialized default to null in the beginning. We saw the int is initialized to zero. But the local variables, we need to initialize them. They are not automatically initialized. When a method terminates, the value of the local variable is also lost. The local variable, it comes only inside the methods. So unlike local variables, the instance variables or the attributes inside the class, they are not like local variables. They have their initial value whenever the class object is created. The initial value for the string null, for integer 0, for double 0.0, for boolean, what is the initial value? False, okay, and so on. Instance variables, they are declared as private. and I told you why they are private. Private is an access modifier and they are declared as private because to hide the data from outside the class. Okay, yeah, this declaration of private, we call it as in data hiding or information hiding. Data hiding or information hiding. So every object information, every object name, every object age, every object salary, it is hidden. You can access these only through the methods, only through the public methods, either by calling get method or by calling display info. Okay, so this concept of making it private and hiding it from outside the class, we call it as in data hiding. The next is about the employee class. The employee class we cannot run because it does not have the main method. Okay, even if you try to run, you will get this error: exception in thread main, Java long, no such method error main. This is a error what you get. Creating an object of the class, I show you that how you create an object of the class. Okay, to call these any of these public methods of the class, you need to create an object and use the dot with the object to call the public methods. Okay, only the static methods, a static method like a main, how we write the main, we write public static void main. The static methods can only be run without creating object. That's why you see when we run the program, we don't create any object, we directly run the program. For example, here we see we run this employee test without creating any object. Why? Because we have a main method for execution and it is static. In the same fashion, if you want to run this class, it will not run because there is no main method. Okay, but here there is a main method and this main method is static. And to run these methods, what we have, this display info, set name, set age, set salary, get name, get age, get salary, we need to create an object here. We create an object and we use this object to call these methods, to run those methods. Okay, because they are not static. If you have a static method, that can be run without creating object. If it is inside the class, you can create it. Outside the class also, you can run that by calling the name of the class. Name of the class and the name of the method. Now, how we create an object is by using the keyword new. Class instance creation expression. Instance, it means the object. So how we create the instance? By using the new. As we saw in our example, we created employee emp1 is equal to new employee. So we use this operator new to create the instance of the object, instance of the class or object of the class. And we use that object, by a dot operator, by a dot separator to call the methods. So if, for example, emp1.displayInfo, emp1.setName, emp1.getName. So we use this one. And when we create an object, we call the constructor. As we saw in our program, when we are creating this object, we are calling the constructor, employee. This is a default constructor. It will call this default constructor, which is this one. And the second constructor we are calling, this is a parameterized constructor. And it will call this parameterized constructor. Okay? But if there is no constructor, the default will be there automatically. Get and set. Yeah, get and set. If you want to change the name and the age and all, we use the get and set. So here is an example for set name and get name. See, in the display info, we can use this getName method. Instead of just writing the name directly, you can call this one. This will return the name. So again, the same thing, it will come the name. Okay? So in the exam, they may tell you that use the getName to get the name, to print the name. So you have to call their getName method. Without set. This is just to display. To display, we use get, not set.
Get set, we use just environment.
Get set.
Get or set, you use just environment.
These are private, these are public.
Variables.
Variables. Yes. For the variables, we write the getter and setter for variables only. Fine. Get, set and get methods, I just explain you what is the set and get method. Okay. We this is the these are called setter and getter method, also called mutator and accessor methods. Mutator is a setter, accessor is a getter method. This is to get and the set the values of the attributes. Okay. So here is an example. You create an object, how you create an object, how you set the name, display info, create another object, read the value, set the name using that reading value, and then display by using get name. Okay. Now here is some notes on import declaration. The class system and the string are in the package java.lang and they are imported automatically. But it comes from a default package. It comes from a default package, the class where you use the scan, where you use the system.out.println, the system class, and the math class. This comes from the default package called java.lang. This lang package is available for every class. But if you want to use a class which is in some packages, then you have to use an import statement. Like you do import java.util.scanner, right? In your program to take the scanner object. So in the same fashion, for any class that you want from outside the package, from any other package, you have to import that. If it is in the same package, you can call it. But if it is in outside the another package, you have to write an import statement. Either you write an import statement or you use the fully qualified name. For example, java.util.scanner is equal to input is equal to new java.util.scanner. Yeah. This one does not require the import statement. You just write where you want, you write that. From beginning, java.util.scanner. Or if you do the import, then no need to write the java.util.scanner. You just write a scanner. Okay. So this type of declaring or accessing the class is called fully qualified class name. Fully qualified class name. Without import, yeah.
We need to take any value from the user, we need to
print yes. Yes. Without import.
Every time.
We need to print all the time you need. Okay. The next is talking about the initializing object with a constructor. I told you that how we can initialize the object with a constructor. There is a default constructor without arguments. Okay, default constructor is without argument. The default constructor will not take any argument and it is it will just set the default values. To set the default values, you can set any default value for the variables inside the default constructor. As you see in this one, we have this employee default constructor without argument. We set some default values here, whatever you want as a default value. Okay. So this is a default. For example, I'll set the name null. Age, default, I want age to be 18, a default age, not less than 18. Then age 18, salary, default salary 500. So now this becomes the default value for any object which is created by using this constructor. For example, here we are creating EMP1 by using this default constructor. So for the EMP1, the name is null, the age is 18, salary is 500, the default values. Okay, and you see constructor always public. They do not return any value. They don't have a return type, not even void. And constructor has the same name as the class name. See, here is an example for the constructor. Calling the parameterized constructor. Okay, it is same like what we did here, calling the parameterized constructor This is a parameterized constructor. We call it when we create an object and we pass the parameter values. You can write one parameter constructor, two parameter constructor, three parameter, all values. Okay, it depends based on the request. You can write that. Garbage collection. See, in Java there is a concept called garbage collection. What is this garbage collection? Whenever we create an object, this object takes the memory from the computer because it has some attributes. For example, in our case, it has, every object has a three attributes: string name, int age, double salary. Let's say that this will take some memory in the computer. Every object, we create two objects here, emp1, emp2. emp1 takes some memory from the computer, emp2 takes some memory from the computer. Like this, if we create 100 objects, 100 objects, they will take memory from the computer. But when we don't use it, let's say this emp1 has taken this memory, emp2 has taken the memory. After we finish our program, we are not using this emp1 or emp2. Now the memory taken by the emp1 and emp2, what it should be? It should be freed. It should be remove all the contents and make it free, right? So who will do this job? We have in Java, there is a concept called garbage collection, done by a garbage collector. The garbage collector will run in the memory to see the objects which are not in use, which are discarded, no more in use, and they'll clean it, they'll remove it, delete all these objects, make the memory free. To make this memory free, and it is done automatically. Okay, so the JVM performs automatic garbage collection to reclaim the memory occupied by the object that are no longer in use. So when there is no more references to the object is eligible to be collected. Collected, it means to be deleted and free the memory. So this typical occurs when the JVM execute the garbage collector. When the JVM execute the garbage collector, this will happen. It will see the objects, those are no more in use, and they will be free. Okay. The next we talk about scope of declaration. Declaring the variables and their scope, where they will be, the local variables or the global variables. So declaration introduces names that can be used to refer the Java entities, like variables and objects. The scope of declaration is the portion of the program that can refer to the declare entity by its name. We'll take the basic rules for this scope is that the scope of parameter declaration is in the body of the method in which the declaration appears. Here we have the parameters. What is a name, a age, a salary? Their scope, where they are executed. They are executed only the body, in this, the body of this object, only here, not outside here. Because their scope is only to that method or to that constructor. We use here again set name, a name. This a name is only to this body, not outside this body. Yeah, this means the scope of that variable. So the first rule is that the scope of parameter declaration is the body of the method in which the declaration appears. Number two, the scope of local variable declaration is from the point at which the declaration appears to the end of that block. Where you start the declaration, from where till the end of that block. So for example, inside a method, this is a block. I declare a variable here, int x. This x is available till the end of this block, till here. From here till the end here. After this end, after the end of this block, this x variable is not there. It's not exist. Then the scope of local variable declaration appears in the initialization section of a for statement. Header is in the body of the for statement. In the for statement, what we write for int I is equal to 0, I less than array dot length I plus plus. This I, what we declare for int I is equal to 0, this I is available only in the for statement, not outside the for. So it's a local variable. A method or a field, a scope is inside the body of the class. It means that the scope, what is the scope of here in this class, the scope of the name variable, scope of age, scope of salary is inside this class, because these are the variables inside the class, declared inside. So this name, age and salary you can use anywhere inside the class. This one, a name, a age, a salary is only inside this constructor. Then here a name is only in this method, a age only in this method, a salary only is. This a salary is different from this a salary, because this is local here and this is local over here. This a age is different from this a age. This a name is different from this a name, because this a name is local here and this a name is local here. Okay, but the name, salary, the name, age and the salary of the class, the fields of the class, they are everywhere same, because they are like a global. Okay, so their scope is in the entire body of the class. Now if we have two variables, one local inside a method, another a global one outside the method, then the local inside the method, the local will be taken and the main the global one will not be taken. For example, yeah, we have a class here scope, and we have a private variable x is equal to 1. Yeah, this is the class one. The scope is inside the class. Yeah, it is. Now here use local int x is equal to 25. Now here in this use local method we are declaring x which is equal to 25. Here we are declaring x which is equal to 1. Now what will happen? This x inside this local method, this x will be taken. So it will print local x, it will print how much? 25. Plus plus x will make it 26, and it will print 26. Now use field, the field value, this is a field value. Field x, it will display 1, because the field is 1, so it will display 1. X is equal to x into 10, 1 into 10, 10, so now the field is 10. Okay, now here also x, the local also, the local inside use local also x. This concept is called it as an shadowing. Shadowing, it means that having the same name of the variable, I mean two variables of same name, one is as a field variable inside the class, other in a local as a local variable inside a method. This concept we call it as an shadowing. So if you create an object of this class, scope class, and we say we write a main method here, we not create an object inside the same class, we say int x is equal to 5 here. Now first statement, system.out.println field x is 1. Then we write a local x, x 5. Local x is 5. We call use local. Use local is this one. It comes here and say x 25, display 25 and 26. So it will display now 25 and 26. Use field. Now it will use field 1. Field now. So it will use, call this method, it is display x 1, 10, 1 and 10. Then again it will call use local. Use local is again the same thing, 25, 26. And use field, now 10, no, 10, because it is modified. It is modified to how much? 10, last time. So it is 10 and, 10 and 10 into 10, 100. Because it is called use field. In the first call use field, you change the field value. Yes. Yeah. In the first, second one, 10. Continue from 10. Yes, 10 into 100. So this is about the scope of the variables. Okay, you'll have this question in the output section. They'll give the in the output, write the output of the following code. The next we have a class called time class, in which there is a time method, constructor time, the universal time, two string method, and this time class is explained here, and it is called here in the test time class, in the main method, creating the object and calling these methods. Okay, so I'll leave this for you to study this class. You have one constructor, you have two methods, two universal string, two string, and what they are returning you can see. Okay, so you have to do that, you do it by yourself, that's fine. Finally, we have this packages are nothing but putting the related classes into one folder. We call it as a package, like you have a util package. You import what? Import java.util. Util is a package. In this package, there are many classes. It's like a folder. Inside a folder, you keep many files. And you keep subfolders. Folder inside and a folder. So like this, you have a package. You can also have a sub-package. Okay? And these packages are defined to group the related classes. Util package will have all utility classes. That is doing reading and writing and everything. Yeah, so everything. This is all about the packages. Public and non-public classes. See, Java classes, whenever we want to execute any class, we want to create object of that class, we create it as public. That's why you see every class we create in this NetBeans, it is public. Okay? Because public classes, we can access it from outside to run these classes, to create object of that classes. If it is non-public class or it is a private class, then we cannot access it. We cannot create object of it for the private class. Okay? So that's why we keep the classes as public. Fine? So this is all what we have for this meeting number 7 of the course, and this is the last meeting for you. As a summary, overall, what you had is how to write a class by giving its field names or the attribute names, the variables what you declare, and it is to be declared by private or as private, and then how to write a constructor, a default constructor and a parameterized constructor, how to write the methods, display info for example, or getter and setter methods. Okay, and then what we saw is that creating an object, how to create an object of the class and by using the constructor and the new operator, how to call the methods by using the object, like emp1.displayInfo, emp1.setName, emp1.getName. So this calling the methods, yeah. Then we saw the scope, okay. Sorry? Local in the scope of the variables, local variable, the field variable, or you can say the global variable inside the class, okay. And the last one is packages, okay. Just a definition about what is a package. That's it. Okay, so here we'll stop, and this is the end of your course M105. From here you will start the next course M257, that will be in the next semester for you if you register, and that starts from the classes. You will having in one class a quick revision, next class you will see about the new classes, writing the classes. You follow the same fashion, you write a class, in another class you write a main method, then you create the objects. Yeah, with more details and more programming. Okay, so this is all what we have here for you. And if you have anything, any doubt, anything to want to ask, you can go ahead, please.